Jack, we've interviewed you a few times. I know in 2011, we interviewed you for Some Guy Who Kills People,
right,
which was an excellent film,
thanks,
Karen Black.
Yeah.
And then again in 2013, and now we are in the summer of 2016. So in this current time frame, what do you think the challenges are that independent artists face that they didn't when we last spoke to you those two times?
Interesting. Well, I don't know. It's interesting. I think the age-old problem or challenge of getting money still is probably the biggest hurdle. I don't see it getting easier to get money. I think raising money for an independent film has always been probably, you know, the bane of every filmmaker's existence. It certainly is for me. You know, I've never been any good at raising money, and I think, you know, with crowdfunding, you know, we were talking a little bit about this with crowdfunding. That was an interesting, that seems to be a hopeful thing, in that you now have an avenue to raise money that goes beyond just going to your uncle and saying, can you give me some money for my independent feature? But I think also what you end up having is, just like with everything in the democratization of filmmaking, everybody's doing it. So then if everybody is crowdfunding, then does that make it harder for the individual to get to people, because maybe they've already given money, or it's somehow it's lost its novelty. I don't know. I think in a different way, raising money is still the hardest thing. It's just in a different form now. But I guess, I mean, I'm hopeful about, still hopeful, because I have a project of my own that is definitely so independent that I don't think there was any way in hell I would get typical, you know, studio or even mini studio financing. And that's like one film that I would like to try to crowdfund because it has a political animal rights slant to it. And I think that's appropriate for that. I think probably it's still, maybe the biggest thing is just coming up with something valid to say. I mean, that's just because now the process of making a film, and it has been for years now, the process of actually getting a film made is a lot easier if you have the minimum amount of funds in order to do it. And I mean, even if you have a couple thousand dollars or less, you can make a film, you can finish it. But that still comes down to, okay, so you made a film, and that's an accomplishment, but what is it that you're making? So I guess this, maybe the storytelling, the importance of storytelling and having something, an important story, something original, something meaningful, becomes even more important the more you have more movies getting out there, because what's to distinguish your movie? It can't just be, well, look, he got a movie made on a low budget. Now, that in and of itself is not impressive anymore. You know, it has to be, I think, something specific, and it can't be it can't be a scale thing. It can't be, you know, it's not like you can wow them with effects or huge production value. The studios can't even do that. I went to see X-Men, whatever the last X-Men movie, just to get out of the heat. And I was looking at my wife yesterday. I said, do you remember anything of what we just saw? And she was like, I can't even remember we saw an X-Men movie. This was like the day before. But moreover, when we were in the audience, and it was, you know, your standard summer kind of stuff, and, you know, midway through the movie, there was the whole, you know, a city was being knocked down, as it is, you know, par for the course now. Every movie's got to have a city being laid waste, and there was no reaction. You know, I've been saying this for years now. There's as well done as the effects were, it's just, what are you showing me that I haven't seen? As effectively done as you're showing me these action sequences, there was absolutely no gasping or reaction. You know, that's what those movies are made for. So that's, even on the $100, $200 million level, I think that's flatlined. Even if and that's with every dollar they have at their disposal throwing it at it. So I think it comes down to, what is this story that is going to open people's eyes or resonate? It doesn't even have to be, it just has to resonate. That's what I mean. It just has to be something that sticks, you know? I'm curious, what was the last film you saw that like resonated in that way? I'm like hard pressed. I'm trying to think now. Like, geez, what is the last movie?
Well, I saw Louder Than Bombs, okay, which was a Norwegian filmmaker's movie, which was not one of these summer blockbusters,
right,
but it stuck with me. I liked that. It reminds me of this YouTube documentary that I watched on Ed Wood, Right. So back when the days of like him before he paired up with Bela Lugosi, he, I guess, went to a chiropractor who said, okay, I'll invest in you, but you have to go to my church and be baptized.
Right, which is in the movie. You know, there's a whole scene in the movie where they get in the pool and Bill Murray gets in the pool and is baptized. Right.
So it seems like that if you can find that one individual, but then how long does that last, you know? Because doesn't make money back.
That's right. I don't think anybody can, you know, I mean, obviously, if you have somebody invest in your movie, you want them to, you want the movie to be profitable, you want them to get their money back, and hopefully that relationship continues. Then they become your benefactor. It's like you proved, you didn't just con the guy, you made a movie, he made his money back, maybe even made a little bit of a profit, now he's inclined to give you. But there's no way for any of us at any level to guarantee an investor that they're going to make their money. And I really feel like anybody who invests in filmmaking can't really be investing, or a filmmaker can't really be investing in this idea of making a huge profit. I mean, maybe on a grand scale, if you're getting involved in, you know, huge franchise like Mission Impossible. I was looking at whatever the last Mission Impossible movie was, and you could see that there's like this huge Chinese company that's invested in it, and there's like, you know, it's like conglomerates, international conglomerates. It's like Godfather 3, you know, it's like all these things are coming together to make these movies. Yes, of course, they're interested in profit, or they insist on profit. But I think somebody who invests in an independent film should be investing in it because for the, I would say, the thrill of investing in something like a motion picture and getting involved in observing that process. And it's funny because I did an interview with Joe Carnahan, you know, director of The Gray and Smoking Aces and so forth, and we were talking and we both were saying you sort of want to find that, he described it as a unicorn. He says it's like it's this unicorn, you want this, you know, like this dentist in Idaho who's like a unicorn who just like shows up with a big bag of money and all he wants to do is go to the rap party, you know, which is like the best, you know, any of us want. You know, certainly I don't want creative strings attached with independent financing. That would be just as bad as, you know, working for a studio. You'd want somebody who goes, I will invest in you as an artist. I'm excited to see what this is about. I'm going to be a producer on the movie or the executive producer, but I'm not going to give you notes on the cut, you know, that kind of stuff.
Right.
That's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for that unicorn. I think we're all probably looking for that, if they exist. I don't know.
Do you think they exist less so now because there are so many people making films, and so it's kind of like this one-trick pony, and it's like, all right, well, they invested a lot of their savings in that, and even though there may be more money behind them, they kind of did that and...
Possibly. I mean, if somebody invests in a film, and maybe they don't have unlimited resources, so this is their one sort of venture into or exploration into this, and if it turns out to be a bust or, you know, like... You know, some filmmakers there are some people out there who aren't finishers, you know, that don't deliver. And that's going to sour somebody, you know, or the movie turns out to be a total, you know, mess. And so the investor goes, okay, well, I did that, you know, and now I'm not really interested. Maybe the shine has worn off when that happens. I don't know. But I do think it's probably even harder to locate. Because there's so many other people fishing. You know, it's like you got a lot of people on the bank all casting into this one pool. But, you know, I don't know. Like, I've never been any good at this kind of... I've never been any good at fundraising or finding. And I think most filmmakers can take heart that that's a difficult process. I mean, I just read the book on Orson Welles's, the making of Orson Welles's last film, Other Side of the Wind, and it was actually both... it was encouraging because he made it like a student film. Like he was making it literally in his backyard, out in alleys with no permits. He was guerrilling it with this, asking for favors. And he was this is Orson Welles, and he's making a film like we do at the most, you know, the most primal level when you don't have anything. And I was like, well, shit, you know, this guy at the end of his career is just finding a way, any way. Even though he if anybody deserved to have infrastructure to support his creativity, he was left, because of so many reasons, just drumming up all this stuff himself. And I said, okay, great, you know. And he always said, you know, he could never find the money. He spent so much time, you know, dining, wining and dining all these people, and then no money would. And you mentioned Ed Wood. There's like a great scene in Tim Burton's Ed Wood where they put this whole song and dance on at the Brown Derby as a backers dinner, and you know they're in tuxedos and all this outpouring of money just so they can get money, and the limos are driving away, and I guess it's Bela Lugosi. How did we do, Eddie? And he's like, didn't make a cent. Didn't make a cent. So I think that's fairly. I think that's fairly typical. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know if anybody does. Send me an email because I want to know how to do it. You know.
A moment ago, Jack, you said that finding financing for films is difficult.
Yeah.
Let's take your own record. How many feature films have you made?
I think it's 14.
14. Wow.
Yeah,
okay.
I think so.
Since, do you mind telling me the year?
Yeah, I think, well, my first feature was in 1991.
Oh, okay.
So that movie, America's Deadliest Home Video, we actually just got re-released on video a couple of months ago because it's now considered sort of the grandfather of found footage movies. My first feature was sort of this formal exercise where I had to. It was a typical. I don't know if we talked about this, but it was an interesting circumstance where I had come to LA. I couldn't get a job pouring coffee or making Xeroxes or anything. And I met a guy, I was introduced to a guy who was from Wisconsin, who said, hey, I have $7,000 on credit cards. I want to make a movie in Racine, Wisconsin, where I'm from. My dad used to be the sheriff there, so we can like shoot guns and blow stuff up, and we don't have to get permits or anything. And I need someone to write and direct a movie. And he also said, also I'm going to be in it because he's producing and acting, which is now a fairly classic way for an actor who has any kind of resources to make sure he gets a plum role is to produce the movie so that he doesn't have to worry about getting cast in it. That comes with it. And he couldn't pay me anything, but he said he would finance effectively my first feature. And I was like, shit, yeah, of course, I'll do that. And it had to be an exploitation movie because this was still at the beginning of the 90s, tail end of the 80s. There was still a lot of exploitation movies being sold on video shelves, low budget exploitation. So it had to have sex, it had to have violence, it had to have a certain body count, all those things that are fairly standard for that. But I could write any story I wanted. And the only caveat was that it had to be shot on video. There was not enough money to shoot it on film. It had to be shot on, and at that time, it was 30 frames per second video. There wasn't any 24p, nothing. It was ugly, and I had just come from my NYU film school days making this lush black and white rich, you know, gothic eraser, you know, it was like this, the image was everything, and now I got to shoot my first feature on video. So I wrestled with it. I was saying, I'm really unhappy with this. This is going to look like a porn, or it's not going to look like good at all. And so I came upon this idea of what if I made the look of the video an inherent part of the story. And so I came up with this idea of a home video enthusiast. And this was the time when the camcorder and America's Funniest Home Videos and all that was just coming into bloom. What about a camcorder enthusiast who accidentally shoots a crime in progress and the gang that's committing the crime drafts him into their gang and forces him to document their crime spree? And every shot, every edit would be dictated when the camera was on or when it was off or when the battery died or if the camera dropped. All the sort of tenets of found footage grammar, which you see in everything, I wasn't inventing it because there had been a couple of different filmmakers who had tried it, but I was trying to make an exploitation movie in a way that justified its look. And it turned out to be one of a few of the first ones in that genre. So, So anyway, it's a long digression, but that film, America's Deadliest Home Video, which is a play on obviously the show,
right,
was my first feature. And that starred Danny Bonaducci from the old Partridge Family. He was the first, yeah.
Radio host.
And a radio too. Host, mm-hmm. too, yeah, yeah. So he plays the home video enthusiast who gets abducted.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, and Melora Walters, who showed up mm-hmm. in Paul Thomas Anderson's movies, Magnolia and Boogie Nights, she had been in my NYU thesis film. So I drafted her, you know, but this was before she was doing those films, obviously. And you know, and it was like a classic first feature. You know, it was made for a few thousand dollars on credit cards and so forth. But then it sort of got lost for years. And, you know, when the Blair Witch Project came out and everyone was like, this is brand new and exciting, I was kind of like, 10 years ago, I actually did something like this. And now it's been 25 years, so it's resurfaced. And Camp Motion Pictures, which is a DVD label, just re-released it. So it's cool. It was exciting to have the film sort of rediscovered.
And how was it rediscovered? Like, did you get a phone call or an email one day?
Yeah. What happened was I was sort of, you know, from time to time, I'm one of those filmmakers. I think all filmmakers are so self-critical that you don't voluntarily look at your old movies and see, you know, watch them, because all you're going to see is your mistakes. But I got contacted by a guy who was a real fan of this guy, Josh Schaefer, who writes this VHS-centric fanzine or magazine called Lunch Meat, which is all about VHS culture, which has now become very popular in the last few years, just like vinyl took on this kind of like nostalgic, almost fetishistic, like, you know, the people worship at the altar of vinyl. VHS, funny enough, has become that. And he was showing America's Deadliest Home Video. He didn't really get any permission, but he was screening it at different sort of small movie theaters and stuff. And I got wind of this, and I said, why is my movie screening in New York at this weird underground club? So I contacted him, and he said, oh, I'm an enormous fan, and I think this movie needs to be seen. And he ended up becoming the champion in getting it distributed. And he put us in contact, or he contacted the distributor. And after a few years, this finally came out. So it was very cool. It was cool because I was understandably, or maybe not understandably, not bitter, but just upset that the timing was wrong for that. In other words, when the movie came out in 91, it was a novelty and I got some attention, but it wasn't like, it didn't do with that magical thing that all filmmakers want. They want their first feature to be Sex, Lies, and Videotape or Reservoir Dogs. All of a sudden it opens up these, you know, these gold gates open and you step in and you don't ever have a worry, you know, like that exists anyway.
Right.
But, and it didn't do that. But then the Blair Witch Project was, you know, 10 years later was touted for its innovative, you know, design and this first person sort of through the camera point of view thing. When, and I wasn't the first person who ever did this. I mean, there were other filmmakers who explored this, and I was inspired by them. There was a film called 84 Charlie Mopic, which I don't know if you remember this, which was a film in the 80s that was a Vietnam War movie, but all from the point of view of a combat cameraman.
Oh, wow.
It was fascinating. And it was a low-budget independent movie, and it was, I believe the filmmaker had been a combat cameraman, or he was in the war. And it was all about this particular, taking on this particular point of view of the war from the point of view of a combat cameraman. So it had this very documentary quality to it, and that's how it was staged, you know, and shot. And so that was an influence. And also first-person POV movies, you know, going all the way back to, like, there was a movie, The Lady in the Lake, which Robert Montgomery made in 1947, which is an adaptation of the Raymond Chandler book, is entirely, the whole movie is entirely from the point of view of Philip Marlowe. Like, you, every shot is your, in fact, that's how they marketed it. It was like, you will solve the crime, you will kiss the girl. So everything was shot from this very subjective. So those things influenced me, and I was able to kind of put that, rearrange that into a crime thriller. But anyway, it's been cool to see it kind of come out.
Real quickly, so where did you meet the gentleman that you collaborated on the film with? Do you remember where that was?
Physically or
yeah, it was in
yeah, what? There was a call. It's funny. I think what happened is, I think I went to an NYU alumni gathering, which is one of those things, like, you know, I think all schools do that, that if you're a film school and you come out to LA, you know, and you're floating in limbo like you are, come to one of these events and all your fellow straggle, you know, limbo, you know, people trying to find a job will get together, and you're bound by this NYU thing, common thing. And all I remember is meeting a former NYU graduate, and he said, oh, you should meet this guy, because he, and even at that time, I was kind of worried about being dependent on a studio or a networker giving me a job. I mean, it already felt enormously competitive. All I had was my thesis film. you know, I wasn't going to get picked to direct Aliens or something. It wasn't that, that wasn't going to happen. And I started to think independently. I was like, well, look, I've got to demonstrate that I know, that I demonstrate that I can make a feature film to myself and anybody else. So I can't wait on somebody giving me money for a feature film. So I got to figure out a way to do this. And he was like, oh, well, that's because so many people are like, well, you know, studio, I'm only going to make $50 million movies and I'm going to spend the next 10 years in development. And then it's like, I never had the patience for that. I guess I was a bit of a pessimist. I was like, look, I'm going to have to do this somehow on my own.
Or a realist.
Yeah. And I just was like, okay, how do I do that? Well, I don't have the money, but this guy did. This guy had the money, at least a modicum of money.
Right, on the credit card.
And he had the will. His name was Mick Weinhoff, and Mick was like, I'm going to do this. And I think he was suffering from the same sort of fatigue that all of us. He had been coming as an actor. He had been trying to get parts and stuff and had some success, but he was getting frustrated. He's like, this is going nowhere. No one's going to give me a lead part. So I need to come up with a way where I can get a lead part. Well, I'll produce a movie. I'll pay for it. That'll guarantee me this lead part. And he had the strength and he had the smarts enough to put the thing together. He's the one who got Danny Bonaducci. But he still needed someone like myself to write and direct it and bring more cast and more crew and bring that. And so it was a good, you know, it was a classic collaboration. He had these resources, but he needed this. He needed this from me. And I needed someone to bankroll my first feature. So that's how that happened. But we met at a coffee shop that's not existing. It's too bad. There's no more coffee shops. There was a coffee shop on the corner of La Brea, and is it La Brea and Santa Monica? It's where the Best Buy is now. Can't remember. Is that La Brea or Highland? I think it might be Highland. And that's where we met. And we got together and we started talking. We met there and we kept coming back there with, you know, for creative ideas. You know, just batting stuff around. Then I went off and wrote the thing, and we just made it.
Did you almost say no? Do you remember when he told you and you left that coffee shop and what your process was and how you almost maybe didn't make it and what talked you into doing it?
Yeah, no one had to talk me into it.
Oh, you were ready.
I was like, yes.
Okay.
Because right. he had that thing we're talking about, which is just he had the money.
Right, okay.
He had the money. Uh-huh. You know, like everything else was, and yes, there's certainly limitations. I mean, maybe I would not have elected to make an exploitation movie as my first feature. Maybe I certainly would not have elected to make it on video. But those things were the things that created sort of the stimulus for the idea. In other words, those having no parameters, I think, is harder than having some, like, or limitations. Let's look at them as limitations. If somebody says, you can make anything you want, I don't care what the subject matter is, and the sky's the limit for the budget, I think you're going to have a harder time. I mean, unless, yes, we're all nursing these epics that we want to make, but if someone says you can have anything you want, or it's like one of those questions, like you just won the lottery, you just won $100 million, what are you going to buy? It's almost like you're, but if somebody says, no, you have to do this within this particular box, I think those walls, which can be walls or limitations, sometimes are good things because you now have an arena within which to work, and it's not just the entire universe, it's this. So shooting on video, having somebody get killed every five pages or whatever those things were, nudity, all those, and you know, all those things were like, okay, well now I had, those are the elements that I have to deal with, and it made it a little bit easier for me to come up with the story. But no, I never had a second of, because I was so desperate. I mean, it's like anybody who comes out here, I tell my students this, it's like when you go out to LA, it's like I don't even remember the first like year and a half of living in LA, just because it was so stressful. It was so,
right.
And I'm not trying to scare anybody because this is the way it is. I mean, you could, I know people who come to LA and they get a job in the first month. Like, I envy that. But for me, it was like, I don't know anybody. I can't get arrested.
Right.
I don't, you know, all those, and that starts, to, unless you're like, have a super thick skin, which I don't think a lot of us have. I think you develop that, or you get crushed. Like, I think artists in general, creative people, actors, directors, writers, generally are very sensitive people because you have to be in order to do that thing. Like, an insensitive, cold shut off from their emotions, director, actor is not going to do any interesting work, I think. So I think most of us tend to be, whatever facade we put on, are very vulnerable, frightened, emotional people. And when you come and when you put that up against a business which does not give a fuck, which is one of the most ruthless, you know, doesn't give a shit business, and I know there are plenty of other businesses, but this place, and the other thing is that this business, when you are in Hollywood, plays with your dreams. I mean, that's the thing. It's like it's a self-titled dream factory where if you hit the right combination, your dreams will come true. I don't think people go to, even if they get involved in a competitive business, that's not necessarily, doesn't tap into that part of your brain about dreams, making your dreams happen. So if you're like in this state of vulnerability anyway, and it's all about if you do the right thing, your dreams will come true, that makes you a very fragile person. So I think most of us are looking for any way to take a tiny step up from where you are, which most of us are somewhere hovering in the lower depths and we want to step up. So when this guy said, hey, come to Wisconsin and make sure you write me a good part, but I'll pay for it, I was like, fuck, of course, definitely, I'll go. I'm going to Wisconsin. I was ready. I was desperate and ready. I was like, okay, good. Now I can.
Yeah. Hopeful desperate.
Yeah, definitely.
That's a good desperate.
Definitely, yeah.
So did you envision that you'd be taking meetings and driving around in a red Ferrari after it was done? Or did you also say this is a stepping stone? This isn't the $1 million jackpot.
Yeah, I think, no. The sports car and all that stuff never was a big, that was never a priority. I think most of us just want to work and keep working. And yes, would like to be paid to keep working. I mean, I think that's the dream. All the other stuff, I mean, sure, I'm sure other people have the dreams of the, you know, the mansions and the servants and the blonde bimbo on your arm and all that junk. To me, it was just like, serving that thing, which it's like an addict's thing. I think I've said this before, it's like being a drug addict. You have this need to do this thing, which is make films. It's very difficult to just open up this purse of bag of money to support this thing. You were reliant on others. I just wanted to keep working. So, but I did hope that the film would be perceived in a way so that it would be easier for me to get another job. That's what I wanted. Yes, I would love for it to get discovered and win Sundance and all those fantasies that we all have, but I just wanted someone to look at me differently and say, oh, you've made a feature, which funny enough, going back to what you were saying, at the time in 1991, there wasn't as many independent features being made. So there was a certain perception that went along with somebody who had actually made an independent feature, whether it was, you know, good or bad. It was like, well, he actually climbed that mountain. He actually went out and did it. So that was helpful. It did get some nice reviews and it did open some doors for me, certainly. It didn't press the magic, you're now a star and now the sky's the limit. I still was down there, but I was a step up from where I was.
Sure. Well, even just going back to then Ed Wood's story,
yeah,
which I don't know, parallels, I'm sure there's a lot of differences
I didn't see
you in a dress coming in today. But
no, the dress isn't fine. It's the quality. I happily wear the dress. It's the badness, okay. The overall badness that I don't care about the dress. I'll wear a dress any day. Yeah. Right. Right. Well, I think Ed Wood, I mean, the thing with Ed Wood is that Ed Wood was Ed Wood because he was two things that are interesting about Ed. One is that clearly he was not a very strong filmmaker. I mean, in other words, his judgment as a director was not there. He was missing that critical thing, which is he can tell the difference between when something is bad and when something is not bad. So he was missing that. His writing is great because nobody writes like him, but it's not like anybody's going to compare Ed Wood's writing to F. Scott Fitzgerald, and his directing skills were fairly pedestrian. There's nothing in Ed Wood's shooting that says, oh my God, you know, this guy was a visionary. There are a lot of, actually, there are a lot of directors, or there are a handful of other directors working in low budget that were, I think, much stronger directors than Ed Wood, that don't have the notoriety simply because they were not as horrible or as such a strange personality as Ed Wood.
Right.
That's what makes him so interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But he was also completely unself-aware in the sense that he didn't know, he thought he was great. I mean, he thought he was doing fantastic work when in fact it wasn't. So I think there was a reason why, you know, people didn't take him seriously, because the work was so weird and you know, too objectively not good. That said, his work has always been interesting. That's the thing, because he was like, you know, he was sort of crazy in that great way. Like, he didn't censor himself. This is how he saw the world, and that's what he set down, and that's why his movies are so distinctive. But they're not technically, not even proficient. They're not technically proficient. They're also not technically artful in any way at all. They're just, you know, they're just sort of very, you know, nuts and bolts kind of, you know, movie making.
What do you think it is about giving something a couple decades and letting it breathe, and then it's as all of a sudden this classic or this rare gem?
Yeah.
What is that in all of us?
That seems to happen. Yeah, mm-hmm. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's just that certain films are ahead of their time, or that, you know, the public isn't ready to embrace it at the time it's made, but then suddenly the general audience catches up, you know, with what that thing is. And, you know, you see it all the time, though. You see it constantly. Films that were absolute disasters are now looked upon as classics. And even Heaven's Gate has been, you know, reevaluated. Or one of my favorite films, Sorcerer, which is William Friedkin's remake of Wages of Fear, which is this, you know, enormous adventure, dark adventure film that he made in 1977, which took two studios to finance, and it just died at the box office, is now in the last couple of years being regarded as a classic to be reconsidered. So I think the thing has always been, though, that the difference between a movie like Ed Wood's films versus even Heaven's Gate, or certainly Sorcerer, or anything you can think of that's been rediscovered, is that the movies tend to be good, you know, and it's just they're looked upon as being rediscovered because at the time they didn't make money. But I think that's the thing that most of us should really bear in mind always, is that how much something earns should not be equated with its aesthetic value. I mean, value is such a weird term, but it's like, people just, for years and years and years, ever since Entertainment Tonight came on television, box office was made public, have equated good with how much money it's made. You know, but I've always said that by that standard, you know, Two and a Half Men or whatever, you know, sitcom of the week that's got 80 jillion viewers is the greatest piece of art ever made. So, and all you have to do is look at anything, you know, like, that's why I loved, like, if you ever see the beginning of Robert Altman's movie, Vincent and Theo, is a great sort of way of encapsulating what that means, because the way Vincent and Theo opens, which is about Vincent van Gogh and his relationship with his brother, is it starts with a real, like, Christie's or Sotheby's auction of sunflowers, whenever that was, in the 70s or whatever. And it just starts with the auction video. And they're saying, do I hear $20 million? Do I hear $25 million? Yes, I have $25 million. Do I have $30 million? Yes, do I have a, and it goes, and as this millions are being offered for sunflowers, there's this long dissolve to Van Gogh, played by Tim Roth, like freezing to death in his shack in the winter, and he's got no teeth, and he's suffering from lead poisoning, and he's completely unappreciated. Like, you know, and that's the whole thing with Van Gogh. And yes, all of us would like to say, yes, I am Van Gogh and nobody appreciates me. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying there was a time, whether it's timing or, you know, whether Van Gogh's work, I'm sure there are millions of scholars that have already said why Van Gogh was not as successful, but it's something about, I think the general public is not, wants something a certain way. Look at punk rock. I mean, this is crazy. Like my wife, you know, was a punk rocker in the 80s, and she always talks about how, you know, you couldn't, people spit on her for looking that way. You know, people spit on her that things like hair dye, like you couldn't just go get Manic Panic down at the store. Like you wanted your hair green or blue, like you had to, you know, paint your hair. And like, that was a political statement that people were not ready for at all. You know, the cops would hassle you. People were just like, you were disgusting. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, 7-year-old girls go to school and would dressed in that same thing.
Mm-hmm. Black lipstick.
Yeah, that, and now that's all, you know, something as simple as like, oh, she's got green hair, is just like, you know, that is nothing. That doesn't mean, that has no, that's not offensive at all. It doesn't, if anything, it's just banal. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, 20 years earlier, 30 years earlier, you would have been, you know, and now you, and I'm sure the same thing, you know, like anything political is that way. Gay marriage, you know, 20 years from now, people are going to say, how the hell was that not, you know, legal? You know, so I think the public, whatever you want to call it, which certainly represents the audiences that judge whether a movie is successful, tend to be slow to getting it. And I don't know what that is. I don't know. There's certainly, if you're a radical thinker or an alternative thinker, then you're going to be more inclined to appreciate something left of center when it comes out. But that's not how things are judged. Things are judged by how the most number of people either liked it or they didn't like it. And the most number of people aren't necessarily the best judge of whether something is good. It's just what they're ready for, you know.
What does a filmmaker need to know about cinematography these days? I mean,
oh, good question. In general or these days or both?
These days, yeah. Now that DSLRs are just so easy to operate.
Yeah.
Should someone, let's suppose someone wants to be a writer director, should they know what it feels like to have a camera in their hand?
Oh, absolutely. I think that having a command of cinematography is probably one of the most important things for a director. Doesn't matter whether you're a studio director or independent director. I think understanding cinematography, because as pretentious as this sounds, I hate this, but the camera is the brush, right? So imagine, you know, not feeling comfortable being a painter, not feeling comfortable holding that brush. You're not going to express yourself as clearly. So I think there's also an intimidation because, you know, I was this way. I was never a techno, you know, I was never a technocrat. You always hear about like someone like Brian De Palma being somebody who would like take apart a radio as a child to figure out every diode or whatever you call it. You know, I never had that interest. I never was a technical, I never fetishized the technical. But I did want to understand how to best communicate the images that were in my head on film, and to do that you have to understand the camera. More importantly, probably the most important thing is understanding lenses, and understanding that, you know, a lens, a close-up on a wide-angle lens, and a close-up on a long lens, and a close-up on a quote-unquote normal lens, or have, you know, three totally different emotional qualities. And it starts by looking at different filmmakers and trying to determine, and you don't have to do it yourself. We talked about this earlier. You can also read about, you know, what technical choices they've made in American Cinematographer magazine or in listening to directors' commentaries. But just knowing what's the quality of a wide-angle lens. And if you watch a film by the Coen brothers or Orson Welles or John Frankenheimer or Roman Polanski, you start to understand that not only is the field of view slightly wider than other filmmakers, but there's a drama to the way the lines and the ceilings are stretching across, and there's a difference between the way those films look and say a film by Michael Bay, which may, even though he uses wide lenses, will end up using a 500 millimeter lens or a lot of long lenses, and then where the background is blown out and the depth of field is very narrow. And it's important to distinguish that and not just think about shot size, but what is the focal length of that particular close-up, and what does it feel like to you? And the way to do that with a DSLR is to experiment, and most people have a zoom lens, and to set the lens at a focal plane, like set the lens at its widest, and then start doing different types of shots with only that lens. Don't zoom in to get closer, but step forward and see what that looks like. And take a lot of different angles and pictures with that particular lens. Move it to the middle of your Zoom, which probably is somewhere in the 50s, you know, somewhere in the middle, and do the same thing, and do the same thing with the longest part of your lens. If you want to do a close-up on a 200 millimeter, if that's the end of your Zoom, then you'll have to get back a little farther and look at those, and then put them together and say, you know what, for a scary moment, maybe the wide-angle lens. For a moment where this person is sad and isolated and alienated, maybe the long lens, where I want to, you know, make the background, to make them detach from the background. I mean, you can make all, there is no set vocabulary that says a wide angle equals sadness or a long lens equals anxiety or any of those things, but it's important for a filmmaker to, I think, to create their own little vocabulary and say, or just to say, I like the look of this. I like the look of this lens. And that's why I think so many filmmakers, Kubrick is another one, you know, where there are these dynamics to the visuals because they're aware of the lens that is best suited for that particular moment. So that's a long answer to starting with just understanding focal length, you know, is a huge thing. And then there's so many other aspects of cinematography, which is, you know, when is a static shot more effective than a moving shot? Camera height, you know, should everything be right here, or does it better to look at the moment from here or from up here? And then something as little, I'm joking, but then there's lighting, which is the whole other thing, I think the thing to think about in terms of how to best express the emotions of the scene. It's not just about recording the moment, it's how do you underscore the moment with this particular tool that you have. And I know as a young filmmaker, this is a long way around, as a young filmmaker, I was intimidated by the camera. It's like, a DSLR is not so intimidating, but it still can be. Certainly, you know, when I was fooling around with my first bigger 16 millimeter cameras and then 35 millimeter cameras, you're looking at this like it's this big, you know, it's like a rocket ship that you has too many dials on it, and what does it do? But really, it's still just a recording device with a piece of glass on it. And the more you handle this thing, particularly with the DSLR, the more you go out and just hold that thing, the more you physically shoot, the more later as a director you're going to be able to direct your cinematographer to put the camera here on this particular lens and move it from here to here. And you start to call lenses. I want a 28 millimeter lens here. And you can say that with authority. Every real strong director is going to be able to not only say what the shot is, but where the camera should go and on what lens. If you do that, you're only going to be able to do that if you've done it yourself, because then you know what you're talking about. Otherwise, you're just pretending. And I was always afraid of being one of those directors that just, I used to see these directors when I was like a freshman in film school. I would see these upperclassmen who were like posing. They were just interested in like, you know, looking like a director and saying action and, you know, all this shit. And I was like, yeah, but that dude doesn't really know what he's talking about. And it seems like the crew is making the movie and this guy's just, you know, like sitting up on his high horse like he's in charge, but he's not taking the image in his head and putting that down with authority. So in order to do that, you have to become familiar with the camera. You don't have to be a master, you just have to be not afraid of it. And you have to be able to tell the difference in things like focal length for you. I like it on the long lens, so let's shoot this movie on a long lens. Or I like the wide lens because I like the dynamics that gives, I like the energy that gives. I like the distortion. The more you handle it, the more comfortable you become. Then you can direct with confidence.
How about playing with the settings, the ISO, the f-stop, like how we can, because sometimes you get in a moment you think, oh, this is going to be great, and then when the light changes and then you're under a pressure situation,
sure.
And if you're not familiar with the camera, you can just totally
throw
yourself off.
I think that's those sort of fundamental things. And fundamental things are important, like knowing how to, you know, put the image in focus should not be, you know, undervalued. And certainly understanding what an aperture is and how to open the aperture to allow more light, or how to, in combination with the shutter speed, you know, that if you're starting to run out of light, not only will you have to open up the lens, but you might have to lower the shutter speed because you have to allow more light in to just get an image. All those, like, those sort of fundamentals of photography, which again are not that many. I mean, there's really just, like you said, there's the ISO, there's the shutter speed, there's the aperture, and there's the focus ring, and that's basically, that's it. You know, that's like when, you know, when you go into a mixing room, it's so funny, when I used to start mixing movies, and you go into these mixing rooms, which are very similar to a music mixing room, where you've got a big board, and you've got 10,000 faders, you know, they seem to go on for infinity, and there's all these knobs, and I would look at the mixers and go, like, geez, what does every one of these things do? And they're like, well, actually, it's all we really need to do, all we really control are like these three, and everything else is like, and so a camera is like that. You may look at it like it's got all these bells and whistles, but they're only, you know, half a dozen or even less particular features that really control the image. So I think most young filmmakers are getting to that place earlier because they now possess a camera that is closer to a professional, or is a professional camera. So, yes, but I think the biggest, you know, mistake is to defer that's all important tool to somebody else. Like, I don't need to bother with that camera. I will express, you know, the mood that I have, and then this cinematographer will magically interpret it, and the image will come out exactly as I. To me, that's just a long way around. You might as well just be able to say, here, you know, here's the composition at this height on this lens. And then the cinematographer, who arguably knows more about all these things or is able to bring that much more visually to the table, will then build upon something and make it even better. But you don't want to rely upon a cinematographer to invent your image, because then what are you doing? Then you're really only directing the actors. And if you're going to do that, then you might as well direct theater.
What about learning how to see the project on a timeline? Learning how to cut, do dissolves, yeah. Different things like that?
Yeah, I've always said that. I think those are the two sort of bookends of being a great director is, and I mean a great director in the sense of being a director who is doing what the job says, which is direct. In order to direct a movie to make sure it comes out the way you want it to, you have to understand cinematography, and on the other end, you have to understand editing. If you can understand those two things and do as much of that as you possibly can in the beginning, edit yourself, then you will be able to direct an editor. You'll be able to say, no, that cut should come 10 frames later, and you'll be able to guide an editor to in that all-important step of putting those images together in the way that you see them in your mind. Again, too many people, I think too many young filmmakers, even too many students go, well, I'm going to get an editing student to cut my film, my student film. And you're like, yeah, but not yet. Like, you cut it first. Cut it first. It may not be as great. It may not be as finessed as that editing student who is only thinking about that. But unless you get, again, familiar with putting two shots together and seeing what works and what doesn't work, you're never going to feel confident giving notes to an editor, because you'll be like how a lot of producers who are not savvy in that way are just going, well, just make it good, you know. When I wake up in the morning, there'll be an edit and it'll be a movie. But I don't know how it happened, but I just know. You know, it's like when you pick an auto, like, it's you don't want it to be like how I look at like an auto mechanic, which is just like, I want an auto mechanic who'll just make the car work, and I don't want to know what the hell you did, just make it work. So many producers think that way. If you're a director and think that way, I think if you have this mindset that somebody else should do this work, and you're not clear on how it was accomplished, and I mean that by way of editing, then you're being willfully ignorant. And you're putting yourself at a disadvantage as a director, because that doesn't, to me, a director has a real understanding, a working knowledge of all the departments. He doesn't sit there and hope that the cinematographer tells him what the shot should be. He shouldn't wait for the costume designer to tell him what the actor should wear, or the production designer shouldn't say what color the walls are. You can interact with those people, but you need to guide them and say, this is what I'm thinking of. Here's a storyboard. This is what I'm thinking of. This is the kind of jacket I want. This, I'm not sure if it should be this pattern, but this is from this period is what I'm thinking of. Because then you set these very talented people on a path, and they can build on that. But if you don't give them those sort of foundational elements or information, then other people start inventing your movie for you, and then you just sit back and go, yeah, I kind of like that, or no, I don't like that. And a lot of movies get made that way. A lot of movies get made that way, but they don't have that distinctive mark. That's why certain films, you'll see a certain film, you'll see a Kubrick movie, and you know that he picked that ashtray, you know, the one that's like way in the background, you know, that you're out of focus. You know that not only did he pick that ashtray, but he moved it 2 inches to the left just to make sure that the image was exact. You know, that's the difference. You know, I think you feel that difference too.
Do you remember editing your first project? Yeah. How was that? Was this, you were splicing or no?
Yeah, splicing. Yeah, when I was editing. Well, I mean, when I was in film school, it was a lot easier to cut silent 16 millimeter footage, because then you were just really just dealing with, you know, just the picture element. And yes, you had to cut that with a Revis splicer, and you had to use tape splicing, and you put it up on a flatbed. It was certainly a more time-consuming process. And when we moved into sound, it was more complicated, but still the same thing, because you're dealing with a separate sound element on mag, and you have to make sure that's kept in sync, and it's harder if you want overlapping dialogue or anything. You can't just split it up on audio channel 1 and 2. Now you've got to thread up a whole new piece of mag, and it's a whole other thing, but it was more time consuming. But what it did teach you was to be thoughtful in your editing, because it was such a pain in the ass to undo it. So like when you made the cut, you were thinking about, should it be here, should it be here. Like you really made a thoughtful edit, because if you threaded it up and you looked at it and it was wrong, then it was a whole laborious process of untaping your picture, untaping your sound, finding those 5 frames that are now hanging on a trim bin, cut those in, you know, like, it was just like a long, so what it did, I think it taught a lot of editors to be more of a thinking, because the result of a bad or a thoughtless edit was just, took more time. Of course, now the consequences of making a bad edit are easily, you just undo, you know, you just hit undo and it's easy. But yeah, I mean, it was like anything. I mean, editing was like a bungly, you know, technical, like, how do we do this? How do we keep it in sync? All the things that happen now. But again, with familiarity comes an ease, and then you don't have to worry so much about the technical part of it. All you're thinking about is how to make the best creative choice. And I think that's true of anything. I mean, it must be true of learning a musical instrument. You know, when you're learning a musical instrument, you're just, you know, or you're just trying to read music, you're just trying to, you know, hit the right key that means, and then later it's like language. You're fluent in it. You don't think about it as much anymore. So I think it's important to do it yourself to get over that fear and become fluent in the language, and then you can direct, you know.
When we did our video interview series with you in 2013, I think we asked you some of the best films to watch to learn the craft of filmmaking.
Right.
Now that serialized, you know, TV shows are like the big sort of taken their new place sort of in media consumption, what do you think some of the best serialized content is?
You're talking about the best dramatic television?
Yeah, to learn the craft of storytelling.
Oh, well, that's interesting. I'm a bit of a movie snob, I guess, in that I've always looked to feature films as my nourishment. And I think after watching television in the 70s as a kid, you know, whether they were sitcoms like MASH or All in the Family or
Good Times.
Yeah, or any of those things, you know. I haven't really watched a lot of serial television. Although I do watch a lot of, oddly enough, I end up watching more British dramatic television than American television. And I think that's because I tend to think that the British actors and even the British directors, I think, are actually stronger in television. And I just started to find that a few years ago as I started to watch. And now a show like Sherlock, you know, which made Benedict Cumberbatch a star, I started to watch that again. And I look at that show in the same way I look at any film, which is just like, how is it shot? How is it blocked? What are the performances like? You know, is it working? And Sherlock is a show that I watched, and I'm like, yeah, this is just a really well-directed piece of television. And I went to, and I think that's probably, to me, that's like the best kind of judge, when you watch a television show in the same way that you watch a film, where you get caught up. And it's funny, because like I just went to see, like I said, I went to see the last X-Men movie just to get out of the summer heat, and I can't remember, there wasn't, and Bryan Singer is obviously, you know, an enormously capable director, but there wasn't anything new or interesting or resonant in that. I didn't get caught up in that in the same way I got caught up in an episode of Sherlock from 5 years ago or whenever the show, I was just watching that on Netflix and I was like, oh yeah, you know, this is really good. So I think it, you know, also I think there's movement between, there's definitely movement of directors and writers from television into film and back again. There's a lot of that now when there wasn't so much before, and you could say, well, he's a television director, he's a television writer, and he's a, but unfortunately, I'm probably the last person to give advice on what television to watch. I think some of the ones that people certainly, you know, obviously Breaking Bad is a show that people are enormously supportive of, and they admire the shooting in that. And what I've seen of that show, it's obviously enormously thoughtful and creative directing going on in that show. Other people are enormous fans of Mad Men. And there's a million shows. I mean, I think back on going back on HBO shows like The Sopranos, thinking that show was always, you know, a well-directed. But I gauge that on whether, as a viewer, and again, filmmakers are much more critical. If I get caught up in the thing, in the story, in the performances, and I just get caught up in the story, then it doesn't matter. Then it's working. Then it's a good piece of filmmaking, regardless of whether it's a TV show or whether it's a movie.
It's interesting that you say movie watchers or film enthusiasts are much more critical. Do you think cinephiles are on this other end of the spectrum, and that a lot of these are made for movie lovers? Oh, we love to go. We love the big seats that recline and have popcorn. But in terms of really dissecting the story and how the camera was placed, there's a very small few out there. And what's the difference between a movie lover and a cinephile?
Well, it's a good question. What's the difference between a movie lover and a cinephile? Well, I think a movie lover may be somebody, it's interesting, I think a movie lover may be what you said, which is somebody who loves the event of going to the movies, the whole process. It's not just the movie, it's going to the movies, it's getting the popcorn, it's being social, it's going, it's getting out of the house. It's the whole thing. They may even love the trailers. And it's so funny though, it's like, now I'm getting so old to the point where, like, when the round of seven trailers or whatever comes, you know, I look at my wife and I go, I'm exhausted. You know, like I can go home now. Like, I don't even need to see the movie. I'm like already being bombed by so much visual stimulus. But I think a movie lover loves the film. Maybe loves the film in the process of going to the film. A cinephile may too, but I think a cinephile is more of a student of cinema. Somebody who is more an analytical thinker, a critical thinker, someone who puts the film into context of the filmmaker's filmography and had maybe seen everything that the filmmaker's made and is going to constantly reference. And I think all filmmakers have the bit of both in them. You know, they have the cinephile in them. There's somebody who has seen every Stanley Kubrick movie and is able to tell you which is his favorite and which is his not. You know, the cinephile will tell you why Back to the Future 1 is better than Back to the Future 2, and why Robert Zemeckis, you know, did a stronger job in that than he did in Back to the Future 3. You know, like that kind of nerddom, which I have clearly won, you know, one of us, you know. A movie lover is going to be less discriminating, I think. You know, I think. I think it accounts for why, you know, I was trying to explain to my wife about the summer blockbuster, that there was a period when I looked forward as a kid to the summer because a certain type of movie came out in the summer, which was just big, expensive, stupid, bloated, adventure, action. Like, that was the time and place for those types of movies. And it was good because you went into watching those films, or I went into watching those things, with a different cap on. I wasn't going in to be moved, you know, by The Towering Inferno the same way I expected to be moved by All the President's Men or Dog Day Afternoon. But I was being given during the year a certain, I don't want to say, you know, more intelligent kind of entertainment, but it certainly was more character oriented, and when the writing, it was more realistic, it was more nuanced and complex. And then, you know, it was like that was your diet. And then summer was like just dessert, and you could just get these, And it's funny, now it just seems like it's all summer. You know, it's almost like the summer isn't special anymore because these movies are coming out. That's what's getting made, you know, during the year too. So, I don't know. I don't know if that answers your question, but I think the cinephile is definitely more discriminating and has more to say about the film and the filmmaker.
So how Jeff Foxworthy used to say, you might be a redneck if... You might be a cinephile.
Right, you might be a cinephile if, you know, if you start ranking your, you know, your Kubrick movies from, you know, 1 to 7 or however many they were, you know, you might be, you know, yes, it's a cinephile is just somebody who is able to point out the nitty gritty.
In your opinion, what do young people, so I'm considering people under the age of 25, mm-hmm. Not fully realized about being a Hollywood director?
No, that's actually it's an interesting question. I don't know. Being slightly older than 25, I don't know if I know, you know, certainly everything there is to know about what it means to be a Hollywood director. I think there are just different tiers of it. You know, like when you deal with, I don't think you can really understand how the industry works until you get inside of it, and then you realize how many people are inside of this calling the shots. It's almost like what they say about the president. You know, it's like the perception of the president is that he's in control. And then they tell you, oh, when you get elected president, they take you in a room, they open the door, and they go, you see these three guys? These are the real guys that are making all the decisions for the country. Now, whether or not that's true, there certainly is an enormous amount of politics involved in Hollywood filmmaking, that it's at a much higher level than the independent level, because at the independent level you're dealing with fewer politicians, you're dealing with fewer executives, you're dealing with, depending on the budget and how you make your independent movie, but certainly if you raise your movie independently, or financing independently, you're not dealing with a army of executives that are weighing in at every conceivable stage, whether it's the writing stage, which certainly that can be, you know, if you ever, you know, Google Patton Oswalt's, you know, bit about what it is to be in the development process in Hollywood, and he gives a very sort of simple and hilarious example of what it's like. It's like at a certain point you want to take a knitting needle and just drive it through your eye into your brain, not simply because the notes are, that you're getting notes, full stop, is that oftentimes the notes are just inane, you know? Like he does a bit, I can't remember, I'm not doing it verbatim, but he says, you know, the executive going, on page 3, he's got pants on, but at page 7, he's got a hat. What? That's a problem, you know, we gotta, you know, that kind of thing. So being able to withstand the level of inanity, the level of interference, full stop, whether the comments, and that's not to say some notes can't be brilliant and totally advance a movie, but the idea that there's so much money is at stake on a Hollywood movie that the oversight can be overpowering. And that is, oversight is not the ally of art, you know? Going back to what we were saying earlier, limitations and things like that, parameters and having to fight your way within, sort of that can be the whole necessity is the mother of invention kind of thing. But I think in Hollywood filmmaking, I think that the interference, the level of interference throughout the entire process is at such a level that you have to be prepared to be okay with that level of interference in your creativity. Not only okay, you have to know how to manage that and politically, you know, engage and make those people feel that they're part of the process and not an interfering element, and all these things, and that's something that a young filmmaker who has not yet stepped into that arena may not be prepared for. And in the times when I have done films or for the studios or shows for the networks, and that surfaces, which it always does, different and totally different from when, like, say, I made Some Guy Who Kills People, which was just me and Ryan effectively making our movie. It always surprises me. I always go, oh, fuck, I forgot. And not only did I forget how much I hate this. you know, and how I got to deal with this now. And any filmmaker who says that they don't have a problem with that kind of meddling, and maybe meddling is the wrong word, because they can always say, look, we fucking paid for your movie, so we're entitled to meddle. So don't give me that. You're not, you know, and they would be right to a certain extent. But if you're any filmmaker who says that doesn't bother them at times is lying. And, you know, they have to have found, you have to find a way to manage that.
Do you think that's what separates the people that cross over from the indie world to the professional, quote unquote, is that ability to take the meddling?
Yes.
Because it's that, I don't want to be structured, I don't want to be boxed in, I'm an artist, I can't.
Yeah, I definitely think that. I think the ability to make that transference, if you do get in a situation where your independent film is so well received and you win all the awards and it fits the particular genre, that a studio goes, hey, you know what? He would be great to direct the next Alien movie. You know, let's get him. You definitely have to be able to fit into that, the way that particular game is played. And not just fit, but be a willing participant and not an adversary. Because nobody wants, no studio wants a pain in the ass director who's like fighting every note, and you know, they nobody wants that hassle. So the directors that I know that I came up with that have done well in that world are not only the kinds of filmmakers that want to make the kind of material that a studio wants to make, but they're also able to they're very talented in those kinds of dealings. And they're okay with it. Like it doesn't kill them.
Right.
It doesn't break their spirit. You know, I've always envied that. You know, like wow. You know, I would love to. You know, not be so hurt by somebody changing. You know, my thing. You know, to be okay with that.
Do you think some people are just born with that ability to flow with it?
I think so. I think it has to do with your personality. I think it has to do with your upbringing.
Yeah.
It's weird. I think the personality of a director is some. I mean, look, what does a director do fundamentally? Fundamentally, that's what Coppola said in Hearts of Darkness. He said that the director is one of the last dictatorial posts available as a job, right? So a dictator is like, do what I say, you know? A dictator is somebody who, you know, wants it his way. He's a king, you know, or God. So that attracts a certain control freak personality, of which I am definitely one. But how many gods are there allowed? You know, I mean, but when you're making a film for the studios, you're like the god, sort of, on paper. But there's a whole bunch of gods that are much more powerful than you that have a big, big say in what the final thing is. So you're not God. You're God on, it says directed by, but you're not God. And if you're the writer, it's even worse. You know, like I'm sure writers, you know, so many writers will tell you, yeah, I wrote the first draft, but there were 14 more drafts and 7 more writers before it finally. So imagine, that's why so many poor writers are like, let me direct. Even if they're not necessarily even if it's not their wheelhouse, they still want the control or the illusion of control, because they don't want their ideas diluted to that extent.
Right.
So yeah, I think that they're, you know, and I've learned to compartmentalize. I think the way to do it is to totally understand that in a studio or network environment that you are part of the controlling element, but not the controlling element. And that it's definitely a team effort in that world, and you have to be okay with that. And I am okay with that when I identify that this is that situation. But I would be lying also to say that I don't relish the ultra low budget independent experience, where even though I don't have all the toys and the salary and any of that stuff, maybe I'm not even getting paid at all, but even more gratifying is the fact that right or wrong, I'm calling the shot, you know? And it may not work, but at least it was my call, is something that I think is valuable to me.
Right, and that goes back to what you were saying about the masterpiece that's up there somewhere that we all kind of have that,
yeah,
maybe we can't make for lack of money or whatever it is. But
yeah, like look at like the documentary that was so interesting. Jodorowsky's Dune. I don't know if you saw that documentary, but Alejandro Jodorowsky, you know, the great, crazy filmmaker, was going to make Dune in the 70s. This is before Star Wars, and his documentary tracks how he created this incredible design and an insane vision, and for the studios, and it almost got made, and at the last minute it didn't happen. And many of the design ideas and the artists that worked on that ended up bringing those ideas into films that did get made, into Ridley Scott's Alien. H.R. Giger was originally, who designed the monster for Alien, was originally on board for Dune. So many of the conceptual artists that created the spaceships for Dune, again, the movie didn't get made, ended up working on Star Wars. And so all of these sort of images and ideas that he had fabricated that didn't find their way into this realization, found their way into other movies. And he has this book of, he storyboarded it, and it's like, you know, it's like one of those things, like it's so beautifully realized in storyboard form. It's like a, like monks have, like, you know, like it's that kind of thing. And Nicholas Winding Refn, who is a friend of his, is in the documentary, and he talks about how he's one of the few people that has seen Dune, in that he went over to Jodorowsky's house and he said, "Do you want to see Dune?" And he's like, "What do you mean? You didn't make it." He goes, "Oh, but look." And he brings this Dune book out, and he goes, and Jodorowsky tells him what he was going to do as Nicholas Winding Refn goes board by board. And he says, "When it's over," he says, "I've seen the movie." So it's a fascinating story about, like, at once it's a tragedy that it never became put on film, and at the same time, he found a way to set it down somehow so that it's still been realized in some form as opposed to not at all. It's very interesting. It deals with that whole thing that you're talking about. Like, you have this thing in your head.
Right.
If you don't make it, actually get to make it, is there some other way that it can exist? Or does it already exist? You know, like, does it already exist even in your head? Is that still valuable? Or if the script just exists, is that valuable? I think you'll kill yourself. You'll kill yourself if things that don't happen, that you think only can be realized in this certain way, and if they don't happen that way, and you've made it that way, that it's only going to be good if it gets done this way, I think you start chipping away at your own spirit. I think we have to, all independent filmmakers, all filmmakers have to find a way of being, of finding a way of realizing these things that may not get made exactly as they. And I think this happens a lot. I think, just like, for example, I remember I wrote a script that I thought I was going to direct. And it was a very interesting true crime story that I was hired. And it was interesting. Again, it was one of these situations where somebody said, "You've worked with us before. We want to do another movie with you, but we want to do a true crime story of, like, a serial killer that hasn't been told before." So I was like, "Oh, okay, I'm not like a serial killer, like, historian, but I'll come up with something." And I found an amazing story about a serial killer whose best friend was actually the cop investigating his crimes. It was like this fascinating story about betrayal, and it was true, and I wrote this thing, and I fully expected to direct it. And I had this elaborate ending where the two confront each other in a drive-in movie theater. I'd always wanted to set a scene in a drive-in theater. I thought it was just interesting. And anyway, long story short is, at the 11th hour, I was removed from directing it because they sold the rights to the script that I had written to another company. Somebody else came in and made the movie, and they made it even a lower budget than they wanted to. And the end of the, in addition to it being sort of a mess on all levels, the end of the movie, which takes place in this drive-in theater, of course takes place like in a warehouse, because that's the de facto low budget. Of course it takes place in a warehouse. And then I realized that, you know, 4 years later, when I was making Some Guy Who Kills People, that there was room for enhancing some of these murder scenes. And sure enough, the drive-in movie theater setting found its way into Some Guy Who Kills People. So it may not be, that's a minor thing, but I think, you know, if things, ideas are really important, or characters, or certain shots that may have been intended for a particular project that didn't get made, you know, you owe it to yourself to try to insinuate that stuff. Because really, it's just stuff that needs to come out of you as an artist. You're like, "All right, I got to get this out somewhere. So if it fits, I'll put it here instead of here." You know, I don't think you want to get into what John Borman, who directed Deliverance and Excalibur and Hope and Glory, he said something like, this business is a lot about all the movies you didn't get to make. And I was kind of like, wow, that's a real depressing way of looking at it. Because everybody has a million projects that almost got made that didn't. But I think if you look at it only in that way, not to say that Borman only looks at it that way, but if you start to focus on that, I think you'll start to look at your career as an artist or as a filmmaker as a failure. And I don't think you should do that. I think you need to look at what you've accomplished and value that, and not just look at the things that didn't happen or aren't going to happen. Because that's going to far outweigh, the things that don't happen are going to far outweigh the things that did. So, I don't know, I'm more preaching to myself at this point.
Well, I was just going to ask you that, I mean, because that sounds like great advice all of us could take. Do you do that on
I try, you know, I really try. I think it's hard because all filmmakers are looking to do the next thing. And so you don't really take stock. You tend not to take stock of the things that you've already done. All you're looking at is what you're trying, what's in front of you. I think that's healthy because that means that you still have something that you need to express, and that drives you. And I definitely have that. But every once in a while, I'll try to take stock of, you know, you made a few things, and a couple of these things you're actually happy with. And so when you're feeling really low about, oh, this isn't happening, or no one likes me, or I can't get hired, or why did he get the job and not me? Like, you have to, I think you need to look at what you're creating, what you have created, and value that. Say, hey, you know what? You did that. And chances are you're going to do something else too. So it's easy for me to sometimes fall into kind of like a funk where you're like, oh man, this is a lull, and or this is a valley instead of a peak. And, you know, I think you just have to kind of look at the whole thing. It's like can't just look forward, because then you may be denying yourself some of your own accomplishments, you know. Even if you've only done one thing, even if you've only done one short and you're trying to get your feature made, and it's like you're having trouble, look to the short that you have made or the script that you've written. Maybe it's only a script. Look to that as a source of, hey, look, I've done this. This got done. So it's not impossible, you know.
But then again, most artists are not on this, like, you know, if you want to talk about the DSM-4 spectrum or whatever, I don't know if that's probably an outdated book, but, you know, most of them are on this wild thing, and
yes,
that's all part of our nature, is that we do have these incredible highs and lows.
Yeah.
And
well, maybe that's the other thing that in answer to your question earlier about what does the 25-year-old not know, is that, you know, and I've answered this question before, but that's, it. No matter, as much as you would love it to be this constantly building stepladder, it is this crazy, you know.
Yeah.
You can drop like a stone,
right,
and that just does not mean, that doesn't mean that you can't climb up again.
Right.
But that was a big surprise for me. You know, when those valleys came, it was like, holy shit, it was,
yeah,
like the end of the world. Like, I cannot believe it. But you survive, you know.
Sure. In terms of writing,
yeah,
a script, let's say it's like for a 90-minute feature film,
mm-hmm,
what do you think is more detrimental to a film story? Conflict that takes too long to present itself, or conflict that starts off too soon?
Oh, interesting. Well, I think, you know, what they teach you in film school or any writing book is, you know, conflict is the source of all drama. That if everybody, of all your characters are just getting along, then
it's boring.
How long are you going to? So, I mean, I think there's a tendency, there's a reason why most movies over the last 20 years have adopted the James Bond opening, which is just start with conflict from frame one, so that you can hold everybody's attention. That's a good question. I would probably say that, you know, delaying conflict too long, or not introducing what the central conflict is going to be, can be a problem. Like, for example, I did a film, I did a short recently. It was like a 40-minute short. And shorts are harder because I think, you know, because you have less time to establish character. And the movie that I was making is this thriller called Where's Roman, which I'm actually very, very happy with. It's kind of a surrealistic thriller. And the three quarters of the movie is really this one character venturing into this very disturbingly weird hotel and meeting all these characters and all these terrible things happening to him. but I wanted you to care about this character before all this crazy shit happened. So I deliberately wrote a, you know, like a five or almost a 5 or 6 minute scene in a bar where you meet this main character through another character. And it virtually is no conflict. It's really just two guys who, like a strangers meeting, just having a conversation about stuff. And it was a way of getting you to know who this guy was and what his situation was and who he was before all this stuff happened. And I think half the audience, or the people that watched it, half or a little more than half, really appreciated that. And then I met another filmmaker, you know, who's been around for years and years and years, and said, I really loved the movie. I would have cut down that conversation at the beginning. Meaning that he was saying, you know, get to the thing, get to the conflict. I think that's the hardest thing for writers to do, is to try to establish a character even through action, and at the same time getting the plot going, which tends to be when the conflict is established. So the only danger of starting with conflict too soon is that you've got to somehow maintain this level of drama, and that if you stop, that people are going to be accustomed to a certain tension or a certain thing, and when you stop to smell the roses, you may lose everybody. But you know, I don't know. That's what I was thinking.
Or like with Dinner with Andre, where
right. Well, that's what it is. But then you say, look, that's what it's going to be. And then conflict takes different. You know, it doesn't have to be they're holding your daughter hostage. It can be this guy is being, you know, passive aggressive, and that can be enough. You know,
that's true.
In that context, you know, that can be the Death Star battle, depending on, you know, what you've told the viewer the movie is supposed to be.
Right, so Bourne Identity versus Dinner
right,
with
exactly.
Andre.
Right, exactly. Bourne Identity has different, you have different expectations of conflict, I think.
Right, so when you were writing, how are you weaving in conflict? Like, what are you already thinking of what those beats, what those points are going to be mm-hmm. when you start it, or do you come along in your rewrites?
Yeah, I think, you know, I've never been really good at the whole, like, outlining process, mm-hmm. although I've had to do that when I've written for money, because the studio demands a very specific, detailed outline before they move you on to the writing stage. But personally, I like to try to get to know the character in my own mind, know the characters enough in my own mind so that I know how they're going to behave or react to whatever I throw at them. To me, it's like if you can understand the characters, and sometimes that's why it's so easy, or excuse me, sometimes that's why it's better to base a character on somebody you know or yourself, because, you know, whether you base it on your brother or your mother or your best friend or yourself, because then you know how that person talks, how that person's going to react to something, and then you don't have to make everything up. Otherwise, the burden of you as a writer to make up everything that happens is a lot. Whereas if you know who the character is, and the example I always use is if somebody's walking down the street and a guy jumps out with a knife and says, give me your wallet, if it's me as a character, I probably get on my hands and knees and start crying and, you know, whatever. If it's Jason Bourne, you know, a chase ensues, you know what I mean? So knowing the character first, I think, is helpful. And then yeah, I think all writers probably have in their mind a handful of, if not everything, a handful of things that are supposed to happen that are going to drive the story. But I prefer, probably to my detriment, to only think out the whole thing to a certain degree. I try not to have everything set. And I try to, I have certainly the first act. I know what the inciting things are going to be. But then I like to sort of let the characters in some way tell me what the next scene is, as opposed to making them do something that I've already. I think more interesting things have come out of that. And in the times where I've had, like a lot of us have an ending in our mind, the times where I've had a definite ending, like the whole reason for writing the script was because I got the last scene in my head. Mm-hmm. By the time I get there, inevitably it's not that, because the characters have grown and the situation has taken on some sort of life of its own. So by the time it gets to that thing, it doesn't make sense anymore. That would have been an imposed ending or an artificial ending. And so I think the writing can be a lot easier the more real those characters become for you.
Jack, your IMDb shows that you were an actor on the Chuck Norris film Missing in Action. I think you played a bouncer. Do you remember, however small that role was or large that role was, do you remember what the set was like?
It's a great question, but I think I have to put this straight.
Okay.
Okay, I was never in Missing in Action.
You weren't?
I was never in the Chuck Norris. As much as, and I remember watching, I mean, I saw Missing in Action, like when I was in high school, or junior high, right? And, you know, and I have to admit, you know, it's like at that age, I was sort of a Chuck Norris, you know, fan. But I'm not in, when you think about the, you know, when I was born versus when, I would have had to have played like a little Vietnamese boy or it's like a six-year-old. I mean, it doesn't make any sense. Like, I don't know. Oh, it says I was a bouncer, right?
Yes, so, I know. I
so
thought
in 19, whenever that picture was made, which is like 1986 or something, I can't remember what it was. I would have had to have been, no. It's earlier, I think. I think the movie is in the earlier 80s, I think. Anyway, I would have been like a 14-year-old bouncer or something like that. So I don't know what happened, but like for the last 15 years or so, it has me down as an actor and Missing in Action. And I think I tried to correct it, and it just stayed there. So now I don't even now I don't even bother anymore. I'm in Missing in Action, so.
Wow,
so
okay.
So I'm so sorry. That's probably, that would have been cool, because I would have loved to have been on the set of Missing in Action. I did end up hanging out with Chuck Norris a little bit, because I ended up directing, years later, a show for CBS on Walker, Texas Ranger. So I had to go to Texas and spent a couple of weeks with the production, specifically profiling Chuck for Walker, Texas Ranger. But that's about as close as I got to Chuck Norris. Unfortunately, I was not in Missing Action.
Okay, well, what a cool mistake, though, in some sense.
I guess it's like a good sort of random, I mean, it's better than saying you're an extra in Steel Magnolias or something. It's like, it sounds cooler to be
right.
The bouncer, but like, look at me, like, how could I possibly be, like, even if I at my age now, who would you cast me as a bouncer in a you know,
right,
you know, where I can't remember if they what bar it would have been. I don't know if they go to Thailand and recruit, you know, mercenary. Emmett Walsh gets them guns, or I don't know what it is, but can you imagine? Yeah, like me, like I'm a bouncer, you know, in a Bangkok CD you know, doesn't really
need your parents' permission to,
yeah,
like,
you'd have to put on
job,
like the cork, you know, the cork,
okay,
you know,
right,
like beard, you know, like burnt cork beard. So, yeah. Sorry.
Okay, so,
sorry. So that, that totally,
well, that was a good opening
86
question.
Your first question.
No, it's funny because I don't remember from us talking about this, us meeting several times before, that you ever mentioning that. So
I didn't, because it didn't happen.
Okay. Moving on.
But
all
I'm
right,
sure, hopefully, funny, everything else is true.
Okay. Great. Uh-huh. Yeah, all right, so you want to reset? It'll probably won't use that, but that's really funny, that the, yeah, I mean, of all movies, because I know Dave was like, oh, yeah, I can't wait to hear this.
Oh, yeah, no, and it's funny, because I really like, I like Missing in Action.
Uh-huh.